Next up, last week we discussed how leasing land for solar development is growing in popularity. This week, in part two of this series, Nebraska Extension's John Hay is back to go over what landowners should consider when taking on a land lease for solar development.
Utility solar development is a growing industry in Nebraska, and some landowners may see that as a potential source of revenue. The first consideration that needs to be made is the most obvious. Do the benefits of this contract justify the long-term commitment involved with solar land development? If you feel the contract would compensate you sufficiently, there's still a number of considerations and calls you should make before signing on the dotted line.
A person thinking about leasing land for solar needs to have some conversations. Obviously, we already mentioned talking to their family. Talk to your tax attorney. Talk to the FSA office. How does this solar affect your farm programs for that particular piece of land or any adjacent pieces of land? Talk to them about that. Obviously, your own taxes and your tax liability, does it impact that? And how does it impact it? Your tax accountant can help you figure some of that stuff out. So and then talk to an attorney, make sure an attorney is looking at that contract. So those are some calls that need to be made if you're serious about considering that.
If you come to the conclusion that this is the right thing for you to do, the next thing you may need to consider is how this decision could impact not only you, but your neighbors and community as well. It's paramount when discussing land use of this proportion that all parties involved directly and indirectly have an open dialogue about any potential grievances that could arise during the terms of the negotiated contract.
I want to recognize that some of those feelings are very real, and they can cause stress and anger and things in that community. And so, although I can't necessarily fix those things, I do want to encourage people that are maybe they don't want solar to communicate. Communicate with your neighbors, communicate with the solar developer, communicate with your county officials. The more communication they have, hopefully, the better understanding you'll have. And whether you can stop a project or not, at least you can communicate and have your voice heard. And I think that communicating with the developer can be a positive, because if you can communicate specifically things that you're concerned about, there is at least a potential for them to try to act on that and try to mitigate and reduce the impact of what your concern is. It doesn't guarantee it, but at least you're communicating it. So it's definitely real that anytime you're going to put a development in a place, there's going to be a group of people that may not want it, and that's just going to happen. And I want to talk to both the people that want it and that don't, that this is a tough situation, and communication is really key to even getting anything started.
It's a well-known fact there are inherent dangers associated with electricity. Nonetheless, it's critical to consider the health and safety hazards associated with any new solar development. While there are some real dangers associated with the electricity produced by these solar farms, the good news is, so far studies confirm, there seems to be very little health risk involved overall.
And there's been a good study done at North Carolina State where they looked at the health hazards related to solar, and they tried to put them into different categories. And in general terms, there is very little risk involved with solar. And that's because the components themselves have very minor toxicity. There's aluminum, there's glass, there's silicon, and there's just a little bit of lead in the solder, and not even a lot. And so those are fairly low toxicity compounds. So really we have this product that's not very toxic. You also have electromagnetic fields, of which we deal with every day, right? And so there's a lot of study about electromagnetic fields. And again, as long as we're keeping a distance from them, and that's one of the reasons that we have a fence around the solar, so we can't approach the electromagnetic fields or the high voltage electricity. And then also there's setbacks within that they're trying to set back away from homes and other things like that. And so those distances essentially mitigate those issues.
One of the last things you need to consider is also another big consideration. Solar land leases are quite lengthy and may run through new generations of landowners. So it's especially important to consider how the development will be decommissioned in the future.
Well, when a solar farm is at the end of its life, obviously some decisions have to be made, and that land lease is going to tell us a little bit about what might happen. One is that land lease might be a certain number of years, let's just say 25 years, with an extension of another 15 or more years. So we may renew that lease and keep that solar farm either running or maybe fix it up and have a second solar farm in that same location over time. So we can extend it. That's one thing that could happen. Another is we decommission it, we take it down. And that's a very costly process. And so to try to reduce the risk to the landowner, reduce the risk to the county, and who might be left with that if maybe the company walked away. There are laws in the state of Nebraska that say a decommissioning security or a decommissioning fund needs to be put in place after 10 years. And so then if that decommissioned at year 20 or 25, the money is set aside already to take that down back to whatever terms the decommissioning plan is in place. And so that's to remove the materials. It is costly. There's a lot of material there. The one positive about solar is the fact that there's very little concrete. Those are, a lot of times they drive I-beams in the ground. And so we don't have a lot of things we can't remove. So transitioning that back to a farm field in the future is definitely possible.
If you are a landowner and are contacted by any entities interested in leasing your land for solar development, these are just a few things that you should keep under close consideration before putting any ink to paper. Reporting for Market Journal, I'm Bill Dodd.